Welcome back to Models in Quantum Mechanics on Catalyst University. My name is Kevin Tokoph. Make sure to like this video and subscribe to the channel for future videos and notifications. In this video, we're going to discuss the mechanics of the quantum harmonic oscillator model. We're not going to go into the interpretation, anything like that. I'm just going to show you the wave function, and we're just going to talk about the pieces of the wave function, because the typical math-based problems are really using the energy eigenvalue and then also doing calculations with the wave function, normalization, expectation values, and so forth. So a brief introduction on the harmonic oscillator. So just so you know what we're dealing with. Imagine we have a diatomic molecule. This is the best example. So we can use a halogen, so chlorine, Cl2, Br2, I2, anything like that. So we have two atoms in a diatomic molecule, and they're obviously joined by a covalent bond. And in the harmonic oscillator, we're allowing the bond to stretch back and forth. So the two atoms are oscillating back and forth towards and away from each other. So basically you're imagining the covalent bond connecting them, compressing and then stretching, compressing, stretching back and forth. All right. So the main thing to understand is this wave function is the product of three components. The first part, I say it's a huge, I basically mean complicated normalization constant. That's this whole thing in parentheses raised to the 1/2 power. Alpha is a number we just calculate, pi is pi. Then we have 2 to the n times n factorial. The n here is really just 0 or any integer value, so 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on and so forth. And you would be given that in the problem, basically. The second component, this h as a function of y, this part right here is what's called the Hermite polynomial. This you basically just look up in a table. These are the Hermite polynomials in terms of y. You can see them right here. And you know which one to use because you're going to be given n. So 0, 1, 2, and so on and so forth. Then the last term over here with the exponential is a Gaussian exponential term. This is going to be characteristic of all the quantum harmonic oscillator wave functions. So basically, you know you're going to have this exponential term at the end. There's this same normalization constant. You have to do a few things. For example, you might have to calculate alpha. You have to know what your n is. The only thing that you really have to determine is this Hermite polynomial, which you would probably be given a table. And you just put the corresponding Hermite polynomial in there, and then you multiply these three components together, and that's your wave function, okay? Now, for the most part, the wave function is normally given as a function of y. Now, it can be given as a function of x, but it becomes a little bit more complicated. So it turns out that if you put the function in terms of x, every x has to have a square root of alpha before it. So what they do is they combine this alpha to the 1/2 power times x into one variable y, and then they just put it in terms of y, and that minimizes the alphas that you see, because if you had it in terms of x and you had to put this alpha in here, all of these Hermite polynomials would have an alpha to the 1/2 power times x, and it just gets really complicated. You'd also have this alpha in front of the x squared. Just to avoid that, typically you'll see it in terms of y, but if you need to do it in terms of x, you just make this substitution right here. Okay? Now the expression for alpha is given by this. You take h bar squared over mk, where m is the mass of the particle, k is the spring constant, which would be given to you generally, and you take that to the 1/4 power, that's equal to alpha. But it turns out another way to calculate alpha is you take the mass of the particle times the angular velocity of the particle, and then you divide by Planck's constant h bar, okay? And that will also give you alpha. And you can use these two formulas, either one depending on what you're given, to calculate alpha, which you can plug in right here in the normalization constant, all right? And which one of these two formulas you use depends on what you're given. If you're given the angular velocity omega, then you use this one on the right. If you're given the spring constant, use this one on the left. So it all depends on what you're given, okay? And like I said, you just put these three pieces together, and that's your wave function for the harmonic oscillator. Really, the only one that is really difficult is really just the Hermite polynomial. You have to go into a table, look it up, but just put these three components together, and there's your wave function. Now, the other thing you want to know is your energy eigenvalue. So it turns out that for the harmonic oscillator, the energy is given by h bar times omega, okay? And then you multiply by this term n plus 1/2, where n is the same integer it was here, 0, 1, 2, 3, and so forth. Okay, and you plug that in here, and that gives you the energy of oscillation. Okay, another way you can calculate this angular velocity is if you're given the frequency. So you can actually take 2 pi times the frequency, and that will actually give you omega. And this frequency is the frequency of oscillation, since we're dealing with an oscillator. You can equivalently find the angular velocity by taking the spring constant and dividing by what's called the reduced mass, and then taking the square root of that. That will also give you this angular velocity. And the reason we have to use what's called a reduced mass is because we actually have 2 different particles here. Okay, we actually have 2 atoms separated by a bond, and I actually need to make one quick correction to this formula. Let me scroll down here to the bottom. This should actually be m1 plus m2. Go ahead and close out of that, save. So reduced mass is a substitute for mass that you use when you have 2 particles that are oscillating back and forth towards each other and away from each other. And you just find the corresponding masses of the first particle, mass of the first atom plus times mass of the second atom divided by their sum. And you take that reduced mass and just plug it in here. Okay, so those are the 2 main things that you get for the harmonic oscillator model. You have the wave function, which you sort of have to construct by the product of these 3 things. Hopefully that makes sense. And you've got a fairly simple energy eigenvalue that you can use to calculate the total energy. You should also notice that because this n can be 0, you never have 0 vibrational energy, right? Because if you plug in an n of 0 in here, you're still going to have 1/2 times h bar omega, which is a non-zero energy. So you can actually never have a 0 energy for the harmonic oscillator. You can never have 0 vibrational energy. And that's because your n has to be a whole number, but not negative. It has to be 0 or above, 1, 2, 3, on and so forth. So the 0 point energy is not 0. And that's something that's fairly unique to this model. Okay. Also, we are going to do in the next video an example problem where we actually, I give you some information, and then we're actually going to practice setting up this wave function given these 3 things. So you'll actually learn with an example how to construct the harmonic oscillator wave function. All right, make sure to like this video and subscribe to the channel for future videos and notifications. Thank you very much.